Okay, my dear students, today we are going to discuss about linear measurement. Again, I am repeating the same topic. In the last class, I have discussed about linear measurement only for B section. Okay, the link was not shared in the previous class. That is the reason why I am going to repeat the same thing with the over extension. Right. In the metrology, different types of measurement, linear measurement, angular measurement, surface roughness measurement, different measurements are there. Now, in this second unit, second module, we're going to discuss about linear measurement. Here in the slide, you can observe different instruments used for linear measurement. Okay. Know very well, this is a steel rule, vernier calipers. Okay. This micrometer, a screw gauge. Vernier depth gauge, vernier height gauge, slip gauges. Okay, these are all comes under linear measurement. Okay, what is linear measurement? First of all, how to discuss? Okay, linear measurement. Generally, linear measurement applies to measurement of length, heights, diameters, thickness, radius, etc. Okay, these are all comes under linear measurement. Length measurement, height measurement, diameter measurement, thickness, radius, all comes under linear measurement. Okay, generally linear measuring instruments, whether it may be steel rule or vernier calipers or micrometer, okay, all the instruments, linear measuring instruments, are designed based on line standard or end standard. What is meant by line standard? What is meant by end standard? We will discuss in the coming slides. Okay, two standards are there, line standard and end standard. Okay, all the instruments are designed based on these two standards. Okay, what is meant by standard? First, you have to discuss about the standard and then you go for line standard and end standard. Now, here, measurement standards. What is the standard? Simply, okay, it is something that is set up and established by authority as a rule for the measure of quantity, whether it may be weight, extent, value, or quality. Okay, there are standards defined by authority. Okay, that is called standard, right? Here, role of standards. For what purpose these standards are used? Those standards makes measurements possible throughout the world. Okay, and also they facilitates interchangeability of parts. Okay, with the minute allowable limits. Okay, those are used. The components are interchangeable. Okay, simply this measurement standard facilitates the interchangeability. Okay, and makes measurement possible throughout the world. What is finally standard? Something that is set up and established by authority as a rule for the measure of quantity. Suppose if you go for measuring length. What are the measurement of length here, meters? You can use it as a standard, okay? Or add like that. Okay, some standards are defined based on those you are going to measure the physical quality, okay? Right. Types of measurement standards. What are different standards available, okay, for the measurement? Line standard, end standard, and wavelength standard. Totally three standards are there, okay? First of all, what is meant by line standard? When length is measured as the distance between two centers, between the centers of two engraved lines. Distance between centers of two engraved lines. Best example for line standard is steel rule. You can observe here the steel rule. Here, number of gradations are simply markings are engraved on the scale. Okay. How to measure the distance between two? Measure the distance between 2 and 4, you are going to measure the distance between these two lines. Okay, this line is there, okay, on gradation, and at 4 on gradation is there. In between these two lines, we are measuring the distance. Okay, therefore, when the length is measured as the distance between centers of two engraved lines, that is called line standard. In case of line standards, we are measuring the gap between two lines, between the two lines, right? In case of end standard, when the length is measured as the distance between two flat parallel faces. Okay, best example for this end standard are slip gauges. We observe here in this box, number of slip gauges are available. these places are having at the ends two flat faces. Those two flat faces are parallel to each other. In between, observe the cursor here. In between this end and this end, you are going to measure the gap as 70 mm. Okay, so in between two parallel faces, parallel flat faces, if you measure the distance, then it is called end standard. Okay, next, coming to wavelength standard. In this case, the distance between wavelengths of light, distance between wavelength of light is used as the wavelength standard. Here different rays are there, gamma rays, x-rays, infrared rays. Okay, different rays are there. Always are going to measure, okay, the distance between wavelength of lights. Okay, right. These are the different three standards for measurement. Sorry, measurement standards. These are measurement standards. Okay, line standard, end standard, and wavelength standard. Right. Coming to next slide. Here, in this case, line standard versus end standard. Difference between line standard and end standards. How to take the measurement in line standard and how to take the measurement in end standard. Here, if you observe, this is a steel rule or meter tape. Okay. On this, how to take the measurement of given workpiece. Okay, the workpiece is okay, parallel to edge of the steel rule, and you are going to measure the distance or length. The workpiece as the distance between two lines, right? Here in this case, okay, end standard, you are going to measure the distance or the diameter of the workpiece as the gap between two flat parallel faces. Here the snap case, this is one flat surface and this is another flat surface. Those two flat surfaces are parallel to each other. In between those two faces, you are going to measure the dimension of the workpiece. Here the workpiece is placed between the two flat faces and you are measuring the diameter as the distance between these two faces. Okay, right. Next, coming to difference, complete difference between line standard and end standard based on their characteristics. Okay, different characteristics of the principle, measurement, error, accuracy, manufacture and cost, effect of use. Based on all these six characteristics, we are going to differentiate the line standard and end standards. Okay, if you take the first characteristic as principle, okay, in the case of line standard, length is measured between two lines. This is the principle. Length is measured between two lines. But in case of end standard, length is expressed between two parallel flat surfaces. Okay, that is the principle. Okay, coming to measurement, it is simple. Okay, use of steel rule is very simple and quick measurement. Okay, coming to end standards. Suppose if you take the vernier calipers or the micrometer as example for end standards. Okay, so it takes some time when compared with the steel rule. Line standard, the measurement takes time. Okay, right. According to error, in case of line standard, there exists a possibility of parallax error. Okay, while observing the lines, engraved lines, always the observer has to see the lines without any parallax error, without any inclination, you have to observe the lines. Okay, so there is a possibility while observing the lines that is called parallax error in case of line standard. But in case of end standard, error exists, but not due to parallax error, due to ringing or change in temperature. Okay, here the slip gauges are considered as the end standard measurements. Okay, those slip gauges are combined together in order to get the large dimension. Okay, while combining those, combining means ringing. Ringing those, there exists some errors. There exists some gap between those two slip gauges. So there is a possibility to exist error between two slip gauges in case of ringing, or because of temperature variation, the metals automatically subjected to expansion. Okay, under low temperature, they're subjected to contraction, compression. Right. Accuracy. Based on accuracy, line standards or end standards can also be differentiated. Here, in this case, line standard accuracy is up to plus or minus 0.2 mm only. Okay, unless provided the magnifying glass, right? Coming to understandards, okay, here the accuracy is 0.001 mm, okay, more accurate. Understandard measurement is more accurate than line standard. Next, manufacture and cost. Okay, we observe the line standard instruments, suppose if you steel goal, it is very used to manufacture, and its cost also, cost of manufacturing also variable. But in case of understandard instruments, micrometer or vernier calipers or the slip gauges, okay, it is complex to manufacture, and the cost of manufacturing is also high, right? According to effect of use, for continuous, if you use the steel rule or the vernier calipers or the slip gauges continuously, these in the line standard for the steel rule, end of the scale is subjected to wear. End of the scale is subjected to wear. When the steel rule is used continuously, its ends are subjected to wear. Automatically, the marking lines also disappear, right? In case of end standard, due to continuous use, measuring faces get worn out. Okay, therefore, special end pieces may be needed. They should be hardened. Okay, like that, hardened materials are to be provided at the end faces of the end standard measuring instruments. It's very important, the line standard and end standards in exam point of view. Okay, always remember this line standard, end standard, right? Coming to instruments, already standards are completed, line standard and end standard. Based on those line standard and end standard, different measurements, different measuring instruments are there. Okay, classification of measuring instruments, linear measuring instruments. Okay, those are classified based on the measurement, direct measuring instruments and indirect measuring instruments. Based on the method of measurement, direct measuring means in this case the quantity to be measured is directly measured without any calculations or any formula. Okay, that is direct measuring instruments. Okay, if the instrument is used to measure a quantity without any calculation, that is direct measuring instrument. What are the examples for direct measuring instruments? Example, very simple example is the steel rule. Okay, right. Indirect measuring instruments. What are indirect measuring instruments? In this case, the measurements are physical quantities are measured indirectly. Just example, in case of sine bar, we're going to measure the angle. Okay, we're using the formula sine theta equal to h by r. Here we are going to measure the angle, but indirectly we are measuring the height of the slip gauges. By using the height of slip gauges, we're going to measure the angle, right? Right, measuring instruments can be further classified as these direct measuring instruments. Always are going to discuss about direct measuring instruments, okay, in these topics, right? These direct measuring instruments are further classified as graduated instruments and non-graduated instruments. If the instruments are having engraved lines or markings, okay, those are called graduated instruments. What are non-graduated instruments? If there are no engraved lines, those are called non-graduated instruments. What are the examples for graduated instruments? Rules, vernier calipers, vernier height gauge, vernier depth gauge, micrometers, dial indicators, all comes under graduated instruments. What about non-graduated instruments list? Okay, if you observe here, calipers, not vernier calipers, simply it is a caliper. Okay, non-graduated instruments, it is caliper, wire gauges, true pitch gauges, radius gauges, thickness gauges, slip gauges. All these comes under non-graduated instruments. Okay, so based on the method of measurement, always you are going, you are concentrating on direct measuring instruments. Indirect measuring instruments, again there are two types, graduated instruments and non-graduated instruments. Okay, next, observe here the figures are given here, the vernier calipers, micrometer, vernier height gauge, vernier depth gauge, all these are graduated measuring instrument, direct graduated measuring instrument, right? This slide, you can observe non-graduated measuring instruments. Here, there are no engraved lines on the measuring instruments. Okay, caliper. This is outward caliper, inward caliper, outward caliper. Different types of calipers are all there. Spring caliper, like that. Here, wire gauges, screw pitch gauges. Okay, in the previous classes, you know that in the previous class, I'll discuss the wire gauges and screw pitch gauges. they will not have any engraved lines on their okay surface. Simply they are long graded instruments, right? Linear measuring instrument. Okay. Again, the linear measuring instruments again classified based on their accuracy requirement. Accuracy requirement. Okay. Two classes are there: non-precision type instruments and precision type instruments. Okay. Non-precision type instruments include steel rule, caliper, divider, depth gauge, telescope. In this case, the accuracy is very low when compared with precision type instruments. It includes vernier caliper, vernier height gauge, vernier depth gauge, micrometer. Precision type instruments, nothing but instruments having more accuracy. Non-precision instruments, okay, here the accuracy is low, right? Here it is the glance of all instruments. Okay, based on gradations, accuracy, non-graduated, graduated, okay, like that. Okay, this is the glance of all the measuring instruments, right? Coming to steel rule, know very well about the steel rule. Most commonly used linear instrument. Okay, it is having engraved lines on its surface like this. Okay, simply it is the prototype of international meter, right? It is least count is 1 mm. In some cases, 0.5 mm scales are also available. And these steel rules are available in different ranges. They are from 150, 300, 600 up to maximum 1000 mm, 1 meter, right? They can be used for direct comparison. Then the workpiece whose dimension is to be measured is directly placed there, okay, parallel to the edge of the steel rule, and you can take the direct measurement, right? So direct comparison. Sometimes these two rules are used in conjunction with the calipers. Why? Because the calipers are not having gradations. Simply those are used to take the reading. Okay, and the complete measurement is simply compared with the steel rule. Okay, suppose if you want to measure the diameter of the work part using a caliper, simply that the caliper takes the dimension. And this dimension is again compared with the steel rule in order to get the value, numerical value, right? Right. Here, these steel rules are anodized profile with minimum thickness. Here, right? They are made of spring steel and chrome plated to prevent corrosion, right? But what is the disadvantage with the steel rule? This steel rule parallax scatter. Okay, main problem with the steel rule is parallax scatter. Okay, nowadays digital scales are also available. Those are used to measure travel of machines. Example, drilling and milling machines. Digital scales are also available, as shown in the figure. Okay, these scales measure the rate of 1.5 meter per second. Okay, and these are equipped with the digital display, liquid crystal display. Right, this advanced steel rules. Right. Okay, as discussed, steel rules. There is a problem, that is parallax error. Okay, if you observe the A figure, in this case workpiece is placed at some distance between distance from the steel rule. There is a gap between the workpiece and steel rule. Okay, if you take the measurement in this case, automatically it gives a negative wrong results. Okay, this is the correct position of workpiece with the edge of steel rule, right? And also, while observing the reading, while taking the reading, always you have to observe in this direction. This is the correct direction, parallel to the line. Okay, if you observe the line, at an inclination, then automatically you will get the wrong result. Right. Next, caliper. Already in the previous case, we discussed about the graduated instrument. Next, coming to the second one, this is caliper, non-graduated instrument. And also it is end standard, but in the steel rule, it is a line standard. Observe clearly. This is the line standard instrument, and this is the end standard instrument. Caliper is the end standard instrument. Okay. Here, it consists of two legs, pointed legs, and the two legs are hinged at the top. Okay, there is an adjustment caliper, different types of calipers, spring caliper, inward and outward calipers, different types of calipers are there. Okay. Calipers typically use a precise slide movement for inside, outside, and depth step measurement. They do not have graduated scale, as discussed. They do not have graduated scale. Simply, those are used for comparing and transferring dimensions. Okay, as discussed earlier, those two legs are hinged at the top. Hinged at the top. And the two legs are spined to measure the dimension of the work part. Okay, those are made of alloy steels. Okay, and the ends of the measuring ends of the caliper are hardened and tempered. Okay, the accuracy of measurement depends on the sense of feel. Accuracy of measurement depends on the sense of feel. Okay, if you place the work part, if you hold the work part with the help of two legs of the caliper, okay, our sense, human sense is very important. Okay, if you apply the more pressure on the work part, it gives the wrong results. You have to apply the sufficient pressure. You have to sense the contact of the pointed legs of the caliper with the work part. So completely accuracy depends on sense of feel. Okay, simply it is the sense of feel is obtained by experience. So only experienced people can provide, can give the better dimension, better results, right? Types of calipers. These calipers, different types of calipers are there. Basically, we are going to discuss about inside calipers and outside calipers. Inside calipers are meant for measuring, okay, inside, measuring inside dimension, that is diameter of hole, distance between shoulders like that. And also the two legs are bent outward in case of inside calipers. In case of inside calipers, the two legs are bent outward. Okay. Next, outside calipers, in this case, the two legs are bent inward. Those are used to measure the outside dimensions. Suppose if you want to measure the diameter of the given circular bar, then you are going to use the outside caliper. Okay. These inside and outside calipers not only, okay, sufficient, so not only to measure the dimensions, those are to be used along with the steel rules, okay, in order to get the numerical value or magnitudes of the measurement. Okay, inside and outside calipers are available in different sizes, that is 75, 100, 150, 200, 250, maximum is 300. Right, next. Nowadays, digital, okay, calipers are also available. Okay, will automatically, if you place the work part here in between the two legs, automatically will get the dimension directly on this indicator. Okay, digital indicator. Okay, right. Least count. Very important is the least count in case of vernier calipers and micrometer. Very important. Okay, we are going to discuss about the least count. What is the least count? The capability of instrument to measure minimum distance accurately. Simply represents the accuracy of measurement. Okay, how to get the least count? Simply, it is the difference between main scale division and auxiliary scale division. Okay, there are two ways to find the least count. This is one case. If you take the difference between main scale division and auxiliary scale division, automatically we'll get the least count. In the other way, you can also find least count as value of minimum division on main scale bar, number of divisions on the auxiliary scale. Okay, you can use this principle or this principle to find the least count, okay, of the vernier, right? Value of minimum division on main scale by number of divisions on the auxiliary scale. Auxiliary scale nothing but vernier scale in case of a vernier caliper. Okay, if you observe here, this is the main scale and this is the vernier scale. Value of minimum division on main scale. Value of minimum division on main scale. Okay, simply it is 1 mm. What is the number of divisions on the vernier scale here? Totally 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, totally, okay, up to 10. 10 parts are there, each part having 5. Okay, 50 divisions. So automatically 1 by 50, it gives 0.02. Okay. Observe here how to find the least count. If you observe clearly, this is the main scale and this is the vernier scale. Here, zero of the vernier scale coincides with the zero of the main scale. And then if you observe the vernier scale, here totally 50 divisions are there. These 50 divisions are simply coincided with the 49 divisions of the main scale. Nothing but the 49 divisions of the main scale are divided into 50 divisions on the vernier scale. 49 divisions, length is divided into 50 divisions. That means n minus 1 by n principle is applied here. N minus 1 by n principle. Okay, here n, if you take n minus 1 divisions on the main scale, that is 50 minus 1, 49 divisions on the main scale divided by number of divisions on the vernier scale, the 50, that is n. So one vernier scale division equal to 49 main scale division by 50 vernier scale division. automatically you will get 0.98 mm as the one division value on the vernier scale. What is the one division value on the main scale? 1 mm. Okay. How to find the least count? One vernier scale, the main scale division minus one vernier scale division. That gives 0.02 mm. Okay. That means you can use this principle, this formula, one main scale division minus one scale division to find the least counts. Or in other way, you can use this principle, value of minimum division on main scale by number of divisions on the auxiliary scale. In either way, you can find the least count. Observe clearly, the vernier scale totally 50 divisions are there. This 50 divisions length is equal to 49 divisions on the main scale. That is the reason why one vernier scale division equal to 49 by 50. Okay, right? 49 main scale division by 50 vernier scale division. Next, coming to least count of micrometer. If you observe the micrometer here, this is a barrel. Or simply can call it as panel like thimble. This part is a thimble, right? Here on this barrel, we are having the measurements. Okay, in millimeters and a half millimeter, 0.5 millimeters. Here, this is the datum line or the reference line. Above the reference line, there are markings for millimeter, each 1 millimeter. And below the reference line, again, there are markings. Those are for 0.5 millimeter. Okay, right. Here, the difference between one large line and small line, that gives the 0.5, right? Least count, how to find least count? Value of smallest division on main scale. What is the value of smallest division on main scale? Main scale is means the scale on the barrel, the scale on the barrel. The complete scale on the barrel is called main scale. But the minimum value on the barrel, that is 0.5 mm is the minimum value, right? Number of division on the thimble, okay, on the thimble, on the circumference, number of divisions, totally 50 divisions are there, totally 50 divisions, okay, right. Value of smaller division on the main scale is 0.5 and number of divisions on the auxiliary scale is 50. Then automatically ratio gives 0.01 millimeters. So least count in this plane micrometer is 0.01, okay. You can use this, right. Okay, coming to vernier caliper. It is combination of inside and outside caliper. Observe here, it consists of different components: internal jaws, external jaws, locking screw. Okay, imperial scale, main scale. Okay, this is the vernier scale, and the depth measuring blade. Okay, all right. Here, these two jaws are used for measuring internal dimensions, and these two jaws are used for measuring external dimensions. Okay, here you are having the L-shaped. Okay, L-shaped bar. This on the L-shaped bar, you are having the markings. Okay, this is the main scale, and here the vernier scale, vernier bar, vernier scale. Okay, it is having movable jaw. Movable jaw. Here locking screw is there in order to lock the vernier scale on the main scale. Okay, the vernier scale is free to slide on the edge of the main scale. Okay, right. And this depth measuring blade is used for measuring the depth using this value, right? Vernier calipers. Here, the vernier calipers, what is the principle? The difference between two scales are divisions. That means difference between main scale and vernier scale division is used to, okay, find the smallest value. That is the accuracy of measurement. Accuracy of measurement. The difference between two scales are divisions which are near but not alike is used to enhance the accuracy of measurement. Here 1 mm is the division, here 0.98. The difference between these two is used to get more accuracy. 1 minus 0.98 gives 0.02. Then likewise, you are getting the accuracy, at least count. Okay, observe here, these are all the components, parts of the vernier calipers. Internal measuring pieces, external measuring pieces. This is the fixed jaw with the main scale, and this is the movable jaw with the vernier scale. And the fine adjustment screw is there in order to adjust fine adjustment. And locking screw is also there in order to lock. And the depth measuring blade is there, to measure the depth, right? Okay. It consists of two scales, already explained. Two scales. One is the main scale and the vernier scale. Okay, main scale is simply engraved on the L-shaped frame, movable jaw, vernier caliper made of hardened steel. What? Right. the principle of vernier scale, simply subdivide the minor divisions on the main scale into smallest increments. Okay. Vernier have fine adjustment clamp for precise adjustment. And the locking screw in order to lock the movable jaw, okay, in order to get the accurate measurement. Okay. Measuring blades are used for measurement of inside and outside dimensions. Right. Depth bar is used for measuring depth of the product, right, or workpiece. Vernier calipers is polished with stained chrome finish for glare-free reading. Right. Three types of vernier calipers are there. We will discuss those three types in the coming slides. Okay, those three types of vernier calipers, okay, ranges maximum up to 2000 mm you can measure with an accuracy of 0.02, 0.05, 0.1 mm. Okay, in all these accuracy ranges, these vernier calipers are available. You can measure maximum up to 2000 mm. Okay, various measuring ranges are 0 to 125, one vernier calipers is there, 0 to 200, like that, in different ranges up to 2000. Okay, vernier calipers are all available. Next. Instructions to use. Okay, what are the instructions you have to follow? You have to, okay, move the jaws in order to hold the work part, okay, tightly, right? Then measuring the round surfaces, you have to ensure that the axis of the workpiece is perpendicular to the calipers, right? Then only we'll get the maximum diameter. Diameter is maximum, right? Right. Least count of vernier calipers. We already discussed in the earlier slide how to find the least count of vernier calipers. You can use the difference between main scale division and vernier scale division to find the least count of vernier. Okay, right. Or otherwise, you can use this formula: smallest division on main scale by total number of vernier scale divisions. Okay, right. Okay, digital vernier calipers are also available with the LCD display. Okay, they are having the capability of storage the measuring values. And they are having the capability of transmission capabilities like that. Okay, nowadays. Okay, working with the vernier calipers. Okay, initially, we have to make sure that the zero of the vernier. That means zero of vernier means here the vernier zero must coincide with zero on the main scale. Then only the vernier caliper is free from zero error. First, we have to check for this. Okay, by moving the movable jaw, to make contact with the fixed jaw, you have to identify or to verify the zero coincidence. Okay, the zero on vernier must coincide with the zero on main scale. Then only, okay, it gives accurate results. Okay, after that, move the movable jaw like that and take your object in order to measure the dimension. Okay, right. Here, the what part is to be held like this in between two fixed jaw and the movable jaw, right? This for external dimension of the work part, and this is for depth measurement. You can use the blade for the depth measurement, and these topmost blades are used for measuring the internal diameter of the work parts. Okay, likewise, external measurement, depth measurement, internal measurement. Likewise, you have to take the readings. Right. Errors in vernier calipers. Okay. Very important. Errors due to play between the sliding jaw and a fixed scale bar. Okay. There should not be any play between the sliding jaw and the fixed scale. Right. Errors due to wear and warping of jaws. Because of continuous use, these jaws are subjected to wear and these jaws are also subjected to bending. Therefore, these two causes errors in the measurement given by the vernier calipers. And also errors due to incorrect observation of scale readings. Here, these are all based on line standard. In case of line standard, parallax error is the major problem. So you have to take the reading correctly without a parallax error, right? Errors due to excessive force on moving jaw. Okay, while bringing the movable jaw in contact with the work part, you should not apply more force on the movable jaw. If you apply more pressure, it gives the wrong results. Okay, but is the error due to excessive force? All right, error is also introduced if the line of measurement does not coincide with the line of scale. Right. Next, errors atmosphere is to be taken while measuring the diameter of the circular parts. In this case, you have to make sure that the axis of the circular part is to be perpendicular to the faces, two faces. Okay. Right. Precautions to be taken in use of vernier calipers. Okay, what are the errors found in the previous slides? Those errors are to be rectified. Okay, by taking these precautions. No play should be there between the sliding and fixtures. Automatically play error removed. Next. The tips of the measuring jaw should not be worn. Use the stationary jaw on the reference point. Next, vernier calipers must always be properly balanced in hand. Do not push the moving jaw under more pressure. Okay. Next. Make sure that the caliper bar and the plane of the caliper jaws are fully perpendicular to the workpiece's longitudinal center line. Okay. Just like in the previous case, here the axis must be perpendicular to the jaws. Types of vernier calipers. According to Indian standard, there are three types of calipers: the Type A, Type B, Type C. Okay, coming to Type A caliper. Okay, it consists of two pairs of jaws: internal measuring jaws and external measuring faces. Okay, here internal measuring faces meant for measuring the internal diameter of work parts, internal dimensions of the work parts. And external measuring faces meant for always you are going to use this type A for internal and external measurement with the help of jaws, right? And this depth measurement is also there in case of type A for measuring the depth of the work part. This is a type A, right? It consists of internal measuring faces and external measuring faces, right? Next, coming to type B, it is having only one set of jaws. Okay, those two jaws can be used for external measurement and internal measurement. Okay, here there is no provision for depth measurement. Okay, no blade is there, so you cannot measure depth measurement by using type B vernier calipers. Okay, a very important thing in this case is these jaws are the more fixed jaw and mobile jaw. These two jaws are used for internal and external measurements, but while taking the measurements, always you have to add the width of these two jaws to the measurement which is taken on the scale. Okay, right. Always you have to add the width of jaws, two jaws, fixed jaw and a movable jaw. Right. Right. This is the type C. It is very similar to type B, but it is having two pair of jaws for internal measurement and external measurement. In this case also, always you have to take, you have to add the width of the two jaws for the measurement taken on the scale. Okay, right. Observe the difference between three types: type A, blade measurement, and two pairs of jaws are there. But here one pair is there. But you can measure internal and external measurement by using these two jaws only. Now here also, but in these two cases, B and C cases, there is no provision for depth measurement. No blade is there, right? Vernier height gauge. Coming to vernier height gauge, complete principle of a height gauge similar to the vernier calipers, but in this case, the main scale is simply placed vertically in the base, right? The graduated bar is held in vertical position, and it is used in conjunction with the surface plate. Complete vernier height gauge is used in conjunction with the surface plate. Okay, this is the surface plate, and the surface plate vernier height gauge is placed, and the work part to be measured is also placed. Okay, here it consists of different components or parts. Okay, this is the main scale, a stem. On these lines are engraved. Okay, this is the main scale, and here one bracket here head is there, vernier head is there. The vernier head is having vernier scale and having the bracket. This bracket, rectangular bracket, used for holding the scribing jaw, measuring jaw. Okay, here one more head is there. Okay, this head carries the clamping screw and a fine adjustment screw. Okay, this fine adjustment screw is used for fine adjusting of this vernier head, vernier scale. and clamping screw to hold it in the position with the main scale. Fine. This system having the flat surface is used, driving jaw is used for placing on the work part and to take the measurement, right? The working right precautions to be taken in use of vernier height gauge. What are the different precautions to be taken in use of vernier height gauges? Always how to check the straightness, squareness and parallelism of working beam. Always you have to check the parallelism, straightness or squareness of the main beam. Why? Because this vernier head is going to slide on the main scale. Therefore, you have to check it for parallelism, straightness, and squareness. Okay. Measuring jaw and scrape. Where should be clean and free from burrs? Okay, right. Vernier height gauge. One of the most useful versatile instruments used for measuring and inspecting, transferring the height, dimension, or plane, step, and curved surfaces. On our plane surfaces, stepped and curved surface also, we are going to measure, or inspecting, and transferring the height dimension. Okay, it also follows the principle of vernier calipers. Okay, the measurement is same, same procedure. It's going to use the instrument, right? Used with the wear resistant special base block, whose graded body is held here. This block is there, base, the robust base is there, okay, for getting the stability and rigidity. In this base, simply the vertical scale is placed, right? Vernier scale can move up and down on the beam. Bracket carriers, vernier scale, and a rectangular clamp for clamping the scribe blade. Bracket means this is the bracket, it carries the clamp, rectangular clamp to hold the scribing jaw, okay? This vernier head, this vernier head can slide up and down to take the measurement. Okay, very important thing here. Here, it is simply vernier height gauge designed in such a way that the flat surface of the scribing blade simply touches the surface plate when the zero on the vernier coincides with the zero on the main scale. Okay, when the zero on the vernier coincide with the zero on the main scale, then automatically, the flat surface of the scribing jaw simply touches the surface plate, touches the surface plate. Likewise, it is designed. Okay. With its face pointing upwards, which enables determination of heights at inverted faces. For the inverted faces also, you can measure the height. Okay. Some height gauges are provided with the dial gauges. Dial gauges, we will discuss the dial gauges in the later classes. Okay. Simply, dial gauges directly give the direct measurement. So, simply, these height gauges are equipped with the dial gauges. Whatever the reading, okay, that is simply displayed in the dial gauges with the help of a pointer. Okay, electronic digital vernier height gauges are also available. Okay, they give digital output. These dial gauges are simply analog type. Pointer is there in order to represent the measured value. Okay, right. With the help of the digital dial gauges, digital height gauges, you can preset the height required with respect to reference dimension. Right. With the help of this digital vernier height gauges, you can transfer the data to the printer. Okay. Right. Vernier depth gauge. Up to now we discussed about vernier height gauge. Now we are going to discuss about the vernier depth gauge. It is very similar in principle, but here we are going to measure the depth of the work pieces. Okay. Here it is having a main scale and a vernier scale and the flat surface here, the flat base. You observe here clearly the flat base. The flat base is to be placed on the work part reference surface. Work part reference surface. This is the work part and its top surface is this one. On the top surface, you are going to place this base of the vernier depth gauge. Depth gauge. Okay. Likewise. Here, fine adjustment screw is there and clamping screw. Each and every thing is same as that of a vernier height gauge, but it is only meant for measuring the depth of recess, depth of holes, like that. Right. Okay, for the accurate measurements, the reference surface must be flat and free from swarf and burr. Okay, here swarf means any chips and dust particles. Here in this case, the flat disc must be flat and it must be free from swarf and burr. Okay, the complete instrument is placed with the base on the reference of what part, right? In this case, care should be taken while applying the pressure. Okay, here measuring pressure actually should be equivalent to the surface being pressure. The reading on this instrument follows the same procedure as that of vernier calipers. The vernier and main scale have stand chrome finish for glare-free reading. The battery-operated digital vernier caliper is also available. Okay, right. Next, coming to micrometers, very important this one. Micrometers, it is more accurate than compared with the vernier calipers. Okay. Useful device for magnifying small measurement as discussed, right? Micrometer work on the principle of screw and nut. Very important too. Principle of screw and nut. The screw is attached to a concentric cylinder or thimble. If you observe here, this is the screw barrel. So simply it is attached to the thimble or concentric cylinder. Okay. Inside this thimble or a cylinder, simply there exists a screw. Okay. This acts as a screw and this acts as a nut. Okay. So micrometer works. This means the barrel acts as a screw. Okay. And this thimble acts as a cylinder or the thimble acts as a nut. Right. And the circumference of the thimble or the cylinder is divided into number of parts. If you observe here, the thimble is divided into number of parts. Okay. The principle, if the screw is turned through nut, suppose if the screw is turned through nut means on this thimble, into the thimble, if you turn the screw through nut for one revolution, simply it advances linearly by one pitch distance. That is the principle used here. Initially, please observe different components of the micrometers. Okay, here U-shaped frame is there for the micrometer and it is having fixed anvil to the U-shaped frame and it is a movable spindle. To the movable spindle, there exists internally screw. Okay, on the spindle itself, there exists a screw. The screw is simply placed inside this thimble. Okay, on the thimble, you are having a gradations, that is markings are there, divisions. And on the spindle itself, this is called as the barrel part. Okay, on the surface of the spindle, you are having a main scale. This is the main scale. This is called as a thimble scale. Right here, at the end, there exists a ratchet. Okay, locking nut also there in order to lock the moving spindle. Okay, right. Over here. Micrometers have greater accuracy than vernier calipers and are used in most of the engineering precision work, okay, involving interchangeability. Okay, because of its accuracy, it is used in precision work, okay, to get interchangeable components, right? Accuracy is 0.01 in some cases. In other cases, you also have, okay, accuracy as 0.001 mm in case of vernier micrometers. Okay, they are used to measure length, width, thickness, and diameter of chalk. Okay, in case of vernier calipers, the least count is 0.02 mm only, but in this case, 0.01 and 0.001 also available. Therefore, this micrometer is more accurate when compared with vernier calipers, more precise. Right, principle of micrometer, observe clearly. When the screw is turned through nut through one revolution, nut means here it is thimble. When the screw is turned through thimble through one revolution, it advances by one pitch distance. Okay, right. If the circumference of screw or the circumference of the thimble is divided into n number of parts, then its rotation through one division, will cause the screw to advance through pitch by n length. Observe here. When the circumference of the screw is divided into n number of parts, if you want to rotate or turn the screw through one division, automatically it advances linearly through pitch by n length. Okay, for one complete revolution, it advances through one pitch distance. For one division rotation, it advances through pitch by n length. Okay, So the minimum length that can be measured in such case will be h by n. Okay, this formula is used to find the least count of vernier, sorry, micrometer. Okay, observe here, the accuracy of the instrument can be increased considerably by increasing number of divisions. If you increase the number of divisions on the thimble or the screw, automatically the whole value decreases. Okay, you can increase the accuracy like that. Or you can, by decreasing the pitch also, you can increase the accuracy of micrometer. Either way, by decreasing the pitch or by increasing number of divisions on the thimble, you can increase the accuracy of the micrometer. Right. Coming to least count of micrometer, as discussed in the earlier slides, pitch of the spindle screw by number of divisions on the spindle. Pitch of the spindle screw, that is 0.5 mm, that means one division value on the main scale spindle. Number of divisions on the spindle is 50. Okay, by using this formula, you can get the least count. Okay, least count equal 0.5 by 50. 0.5 is the pitch of the particular spindle screw, and 50 is the number of divisions on the thimble. Okay, you can use this formula to find the least count, right? Okay, you observe here value of smallest division on main scale by number of divisions on auxiliary scale. If you observe here, what is the minimum division on this one is the 0.5 mm is the minimum division value on the main scale, and on the thimble, what is the minimum division, the number of divisions on the thimble, totally number of divisions, 50 divisions are there on the thimble. Okay, thimble is divided, or the screw circumference divided into 50 number of parts, therefore 0.5 by 50 gives 0.01 as the least count. Okay, if you observe here, the lines which are above, gradations which are above the reference lines are in millimeters, and below the reference are in 0.5 millimeters. Okay, so least value on the main scale is 0.5. So that is the smallest division on the main scale. Number of divisions on this thimble are total 50. Okay, likewise, you can calculate least count. Right, micrometer. Working of micrometers. Okay, initially, how to check for zero error. Okay, if the zero on thimble, okay, coincides with the reference line, then you can call the micrometer is free from zero error. If it will not coincide, zero on thimble will not coincide with the reference line, then you can call this micrometer is having some error. Okay, right. Observe here, this 0.5 gradations are there, and 1 mm gradations are there, and the thimble reading is there, right? Okay, how to take the reading? If you observe here, in this case, this is the barrel scale or main scale, and this is the thimble scale. If you observe here, these are in millimeters. Okay, 1 mm, 2 mm, like that. Here, 10, 11, 12, 13. Okay, 13. And one more 0.5 division also available. So main scale reading, you can take the main scale reading as 13.5. And on the thimble, observe the division which you exactly coincide with the reference line on the barrel. Reference line on the barrel. Here, this is the reference line, black line. Here, the 35 division line on the thimble coincides with the reference line. So you have to take number of divisions on the thimble as 35. And what is the each division value on the thimble? 0.01. That is the least count. You have to multiply that 35 with the least count, 0.01. So main scale reading plus, okay, least count into reading on the thimble. Okay. This is the way how to find the reading on the micrometer. Okay, you can find the reading on the, you can try to find the reading in this position or in this position. Try to find the reading in this position. Okay. Dear students, now you can unmute yourself and ask any questions. Hello, anyone please respond? Anyone please respond? Please respond. Ajay, 307, Ajay, unmute yourself. Anyone please respond? Try to answer the micrometer reading. in this case and in this setup. Okay, try to answer this question. If you have any doubt, you can answer, you can ask me. You can ask me, please. Do not have any doubt. Simply, I am going to close the session. Anyone please respond?